Last year, the world economy grew by 5%, which was the fastest for many years. And as usual, China and not other emerging economies had the highest growth. America and Japan also had fairly strong growth, while Europe, as usual, had a more dismal performance. Now, this boom was driven by both positive and negative factors. Positive factors include increased trade liberalization, which has increased world trade, which in turn has helped deepen the division of labor and thereby increase economic efficiency. Also, free market reforms in China and many other emerging economies have driven growth there. Well, but there have also been negative factors. And the most important one is, of course, the cheap money policy by the Federal Reserve, which have created great imbalances in the world economy. In particular in America, of course, where the debt levels have reached excessive levels and savings have been driven too low. But it's also created problems in other parts of the world. For example, it has created an excess dependence upon net exports to America, and also it has, because of the downward pressure on the dollar that the low interest rates in America have created, it has also meant that other central banks have emulated the Fed policy in order to prevent their currency from rising against the dollar. Also, another negative factor is the great structural problems in Europe and Japan. I'll return to that later. To better understand this issue, I shall, in more detail, describe the strengths and weaknesses of the four main economic powerhouses of the world: the United States, the European Union, Japan, and China, beginning with America. The great strength of the U.S. economy is that it's still one of the most market-oriented economies in the world. Despite everything, it has still a relatively low level of government spending compared to other major economies. As you can see, only China has a lower level of government spending among major economies. And it is because of this factor that America has been able to outperform both Europe and Japan during the latest decade. But there are also, of course, problems in the American economy. And the most important one is, of course, its overdependence upon cheap credit. And if you remember, 5 years ago, the U.S. The U.S. had its largest stock market bubble since the 1920s, with particularly technology stocks being set at ridiculously high levels. This bubble was driven by rapid money supply growth and was accompanied by a sharp increase in private debt burden and the current account deficit, both of whom reached new record levels. And one interesting indicator is this: the U.S. private sector financial savings rate, which is the difference between savings and investment in the private sector in America. Usually it fluctuates in a countercyclical way, being very high during recessions, because at that time households and businesses are trying to restore their balance sheets, while being fairly low during booms. But until the late 1990s, it usually fluctuated between roughly plus 5% of GDP during recessions and around zero during booms. Yes, but during late 1990s, it dropped to unprecedented low levels at almost minus 6% of GDP. And then when the bubble bursted in the spring of 2000, we could, with that background, have expected a quite sharp recession. But in fact, the recession that followed was quite mild. And this avoidance of a severe recession was achieved by a combination of both combined tax cuts and spending increases, and the fastest and largest interest rate cuts in American history, with real interest rates being pushed into negative territory for the first time since the 1970s. But this avoidance of a deep recession came at the price of preserving the imbalances that created the 2001 recession in the first place. The end of the stock market bubble was followed by the creation of another bubble, this time in housing. And while normally during recessions, the private sector debt burden falls and household and corporate balance sheets are restored through high net savings, this time the household spending spree, in fact, was aggravated during the last few years. While corporate balance sheets have been largely restored, both because of high profit levels and historically low levels of business investments, as I said, the households have been on a great spending spree fueled by the housing bubble. Now, and as you can see here, the total current account deficit have reached record levels now. Now, this means that the imbalances are, on the whole, still on place, and this means that there is a great risk for another crisis sometimes in the future. When that will come is, of course, impossible to say. But in more general terms, we can say that it will come when the foundation of the current boom is removed, which is, say, when real interest rates return to higher levels and or when confidence falls sharply. Moreover, I can say that it is very unlikely that any recession will come during the coming year. And the reason for that is displayed here. You see, corporate profits are at very high levels while business investments are still not really that high, which means that there is a great potential for continuing the boom in business investments, which have been in place during the latest year, with more than 10% increase in business investments. Now, turning now to Europe. Europe has for the latest decades or so lagged behind America and most other countries in growth, or at least European Union as a whole. There have been a few countries like Ireland and Luxembourg, as you can see there, which have had extraordinarily fast growth. But because Germany, France, and Italy, the three most important economies in the Eurozone, have had such dismal growth, Eurozone as a whole have also had quite dismal growth. Now, before I describe the reasons behind this weak development, I should first refute a myth about why this weakness have occurred. And that is that Europe's economic problems are caused by an excessively tight monetary policy by the European Central Bank. This myth is repeatedly brought forward by both politicians in various countries and by the European business press, including The Economist and the Financial Times. An American supply-side economist, Larry Kudlow, even went so far as to accuse the ECB of pursuing a, and I quote, scorched earth deflationary monetary policy. The truth on this matter is displayed here. During the latest year, the Eurozone have had negative real short-term interest rates, 2.4% consumer price inflation, 6.4% money supply growth, and nearly 7% private sector debt growth. That is hardly what one would characterize as scorched earth deflationary monetary policy. Now, the source of this myth seems to be the false syllogism of weak growth is the result of an excessively tight monetary policy. Europe has had weak growth. Therefore, Europe must have had an excessively tight monetary policy. But as the first premise is false, so is the conclusion. Instead, the reason behind Europe's weak growth is in part the facts displayed here, that the burden of government is much higher than in the rest of the world, in countries like France, Germany, and Italy. Moreover, the regulatory burden is much higher in these countries than in America. Another factor which have been dragging down Europe's growth has been its rapidly aging population. Europe has the oldest population in the world, except for Japan, and it also has the among the lowest average retirement ages. In countries like France, Germany, Italy, the average retirement age is something near 55 to 60. And this has meant that already in countries like Italy and Germany, the labor supply has been falling, while the old age retirees have been rapidly growing in numbers. Now, and this problem is, and this is very bad for growth, partly because it creates a high fiscal burden, which drives up taxes and or government borrowing, and also because the supply of labor falls, and because as the old age retirees are in effect consuming without producing, this means that they drag down overall national savings. And Germany, Italy, who has had the weakest growth during the latest decade, also have the oldest population, and there is some causal connection between these two facts. And this problem is likely to get worse with time. Some population forecasters believe that the median age in a country like Italy will rise to 55 in the year 2050. If the average retirement age is not raised by then, this will mean that half the population will be old age retirees. Since many in the working age population is also not working, this will mean that simply unbelievably great provident burden for those who work. Now, because of these factors, the outlook for Europe is quite negative, unless something radical is done to address these problems. And unfortunately, I wouldn't count on that happening. Moreover, if America, in the medium term, as I believe, faces a sharp recession, this will also be very bad for Europe, as they have largely depended, the little growth they had have been exports to America. And if America goes into a recession, even this positive factor will be removed. Turning now to Japan. Japan was for long the rising star of the world economy, as you can see there, greatly outperforming the rest of the world. But since then, the growth has fallen dramatically. There are basically three reasons for this. One is the hangover from the great financial bubble during the late 1980s, which have created great malinvestments who have not been liquidated because of the short-term pain that would mean. But instead, it has meant that Japan has had a seemingly permanent stagnation. Moreover, the inflexible structures of the Japanese economy have also contributed to preventing the reallocation of resources which would restore growth there. One positive factor for Japan is, however, the rise of China. The short-lived recovery that Japan had last year was because of sharply increased exports to China. And since, as I will talk about more later, China has a quite good outlook, this means that Japan will also in the future be able to benefit from that. Although it should be said that in the latest month, the great credit restrictions from the Chinese government have meant sharply decreased growth in Japanese exports to China. The third reason is that Japan has the same demographic problem that Europe has. In fact, perhaps even worse in the sense of having an even older population. But on the other hand, since Japan has a higher average retirement age, this old population haven't meant as great as a burden as in Europe. But since the labor force has already started to shrink, it has, in the latest year, contributed to Japan's sluggish growth. And as we can see here, with the likely development of Japan's working age population derived from comparing the population in the current age group of 0 to 19 to 45 to 64, Japanese working age population is likely to decline during the coming 2 decades. Well, turning now to China. China was for long ravaged by, for example, British and Japanese imperialists, by a destructive civil war, and of course, 30 years of Mao Zedong's brand of communism. But since Deng Xiaoping introduced free market reforms there, China's had the fastest growth in the world. And there's every reason to believe that China will continue its extraordinary growth rate for at least a few decades. With, as you can see here, China has an almost ideal climate for growth, with no welfare state, no labor unions, an extremely high savings rate, probably highest in the world, and a seemingly endless supply of cheap labor. While estimates of the number of farmers in China vary somewhat, it accounts for at least half of China's 1.3 billion people. And if the relative size of the agriculture sector falls to Western level, that is like 3 or 4% of the population, this would mean that 600 million people would be moving from the low productive agriculture sector to the more, much more productive manufacturing and the service sectors. And that will, of course, have a very great impact on the world economy. Combine that with the fact that China has a much higher natural savings rate than other major economies, as we can see here. And there's every reason to believe that China has a strong long-term outlook. But of course, there are danger areas for China, too. See here. There are, of course, risks for potential social unrest due to growing inequality and the fact there are tens of millions of people moving around the cities looking for jobs. If somehow the job market were to dry up in China, this could cause social unrest. Moreover, China's banking system is almost infinitely fragile. And China also has a great overdependence on exports to America. As you can see here, China has a much larger dependence on export to America than other large economies. And of course, there is also potentially a risk of war due to the problem of Taiwan, which would be very bad, of course. Well, all of this means that China has a very good outlook as long as they avoid any of these problems. And at least with most of these problems, even then, it will probably only mean a temporary setback. Summing it all up then, short-term outlook is are mostly good, even though Europe will be and Japan will drag down overall performance, and although the economic imbalances are likely to be aggravated. The medium outlook contains the risk of a economic downturn in America, which was spread throughout the world. The long-term outlook is mixed, with China likely to increase in importance, and Europe and Japan is likely to decrease in importance unless radical reforms are undertaken.